morning, Atlantis Mir. Atlantis Mir, Houston, you have a go for the next maneuver. One special request, please notify the Mir when you are in attitude so they can verify their quaternion. Got it, Dave.
Okay, attachment 18 of the mirror procedures.
Roger. Atlantis Mir, Houston, we're going to hand over to East here in a little over a minute. We'll lose K-band on the east side. We do appreciate the letting us visit with you on the flight deck. It's fun watching the cameras float around. You guys, too.
We're really enjoying this, Bill. It's a great view and an amazing space station. And some very interesting news. When I first pulled out chamber one, and I did it very delicately, there was a large, almost what looked like a crystal made of cells, maybe the size of a gumball, a large three-dimensional tissue. And as soon as I moved it, it dispersed. And I believed we were observing the that very delicate intermediate structure that leads to three-dimensional tissue formation, which we use for our tumor modeling and are planning to use for our tissue engineering. That delicate intermediate structure, I did have a chance to observe.
And Dave, we copied that. Sounds very interesting.
Commander Wetherbee, as this change is occurring and Atlantis' jets are controlling the attitude, is there any specific extra risk or precaution that needs to be taken during this computer changeover? What exactly is going to be happening at that time? And is there any other moment-to-moment kind of monitoring that's going on, given some of the past problems that maybe wouldn't have occurred otherwise?
No, there's no risk at all when they change the computer out. By design, when Atlantis is docked with Mir, we control the attitude, and we do that for a very good reason. We carry fuel up to space, but by the time we get back down to the runway, we want to dump all of the fuel, so instead of dumping it, we actually use it for control. Mir, of course, stays up on orbit, and so they would like to save as much propellant as they can. So Atlantis always controls the stack once we're attached, and therefore there's absolutely no risk when they change out the control computer for Mir because they are not controlling.
Let me ask Mike Foale. There's been a lot of talk about the Spectre module. When you come back, what are you, and you're debriefed, what are you going to tell people about whether you think there's a possibility that the hole or holes will ever actually be found and the advisability of continuing to search for those holes?
Well, the answer to that, of course, depends on how easy it is to find the hole and repair it. But the EDA I did with Anatoly, the commander here on Station Mir, Anatoly worked very hard to look for that hole in an obvious place, and he did not find it. He found that the hole there was in good condition. It leads us to suspect a very, very potent area, which is at the base of the solar array, and it's very likely that that is where the leak is. And there are materials on board now that Jim and his crew brought up on Atlantis that will be used by Anatoly during a future EVA to try and repair that area and seal it up, basically. I think that attempt will certainly take place fairly soon. And if it's successful, then the chances of restoring Spectra, I think, are very high. Beyond that, if that doesn't work, I can't hazard a guess. I don't know what the specialists in Russia are thinking if it's not in that area. It does seem that that is the most kind of, it's the smoking gun of the whole issue, because that is where the progress hit, was on the solar array anyway, and that's where the greatest force was transmitted to the station.
You have a very, very ambitious science schedule. How confident are you that you're going to be able to do that and carry out all of that science? And is there any one thing in particular that you think is particularly significant that you really want to get to?
Well, I'm glad you asked. We just made an observation a few hours ago that I'm very excited about. I called most of the crew around to take a look at a structure forming in our tissue engineering experiment, which we're using for cancer research, which was a very delicate three-dimensional formation, which would not occur on Earth, and which is the basis for our planned tissue engineering work for the future. So we're already making critical observations, and we'll have plenty of time to do that throughout the mission.
Let me ask Mike Foale, you lost a lot of your science. Is there still some one thing that you think occurred that perhaps you are bringing back the information that couldn't have been achieved any other way, one thing that you're going to put up in front of people and say, look what I did, besides some of the different crises that I faced, here are some of the things that I'm really bringing back to you?
Unfortunately, I can't think of any kind of big, gleaming, golden banner I can put out in front of everybody and say I learned. From a personal point of view, I gathered a lot of experience about how to deal with these problems. It's an approach to problem solving rather than the actual solutions of the problems in themselves. I have learned from Anatoly and my Russian colleagues that just perseverance and working at it and not being flustered and working around your problems is a great way to approach life in space, and I think I'm going to take that back with me. But that's something people know already. It's just you have to sort of learn it for yourself sometimes.
Let me ask Commander Soloviev, when the shuttle says goodbye and they disappear, what's the first order of business? What's the first thing that you're going to ask David Wolf to order him to go do?
To engage in physical culture, exercise every day. For us cosmonauts, as soon as we are in space, and no matter how well he has been trained, he's got to always train to land. He's got to always got to be prepared to anticipate his eventual return to Earth.
Do you need a translation?
No, we got the translation. David, what is the one thing that you would like to say to all of those people who are concerned about your going, who raised some very legitimate issues, last words that you would like to say to them now that you're actually sitting there?
Yeah, I think this is the time to show the Russians what good partners we are. And this is it's a wonderful experience to be up here, and I'm going to do my best job. And I have a great crew, Anatoly and Pavel. This should be a great experience for NASA and for our country as a whole. So enjoy the mission, and we'll keep you informed.
Nevertheless, how much did all the problems affect your ability to carry out your tasks on the mission?
Oh, there's no doubt. The collision drastically affected the science program that I was meant to carry out. But there are pluses and minuses in everything. And in this particular case, the NASA 5 flight, which is what my flight represented, we lost some of that science, the life science that's in Spectre, but we gained an enormous amount of experience. I'm looking about not just myself, but the whole NASA team working with the Russians in approaching re-establishing power to Spectre, and then thinking about how they could actually repair it and get the air back inside that volume and make it a useful module again.
And just finally from me, what is the future of the Mir space station, do you think?
Well, I think the station's in very good hands of Anatoly and Pavel Vinogradov, the port engineer, and David, and they will work very hard to re-establish the condition that the space station was in before the collision. They're a long way towards doing that already. We have all the modules powered now that are accessible, and David has an ambitious science program to carry out in the Prorota module, and Anatoly has an enviable number of EVAs to do outside and also inside into Spectre again to repair that module. So I think there's a good chance that in the next few months, maybe 6 months, you'll see a pretty much re-established space station Mir. Beyond that, it's hard to say. I've heard Russian news reports that Mir will carry on for at least 2 more years.
How sad do you feel that a boy from Kent had to go to America to become an astronaut?
Well, it was a choice I had to take, and I'm very glad I took it. Because I wanted to go into space. And I do feel sorry for those children that might think they have no chance of doing that. However, I'm more optimistic about that now, and I believe the fact that this crew, which represents a lot of nationalities, and many more nationalities have been on board this space station, shows that very much more internationally, people from different countries are going to participate in work in space, both on the space station and, I hope, going towards the moon and then landing on Mars. And I know that NASA wants to lead that effort along with Russia, and I think Britain will eventually be involved in that effort. It's only a matter of time. The example of what we're doing is just being seen all over the world, and I think it's impossible to deny the importance of that to the young children that are growing up in Great Britain.